Good evening. We are in one of the most important sites, archaeological sites of the world, Pompeii. We're in one of the most important sites of Pompeii, the big theater. 2,000 years ago, you had 1,000 people watching anyone on the stage. But do we really know Pompeii? Well, yes. We've seen so many movies, read so many novels, telling us about the big volcano, telling us about the lava flows and everything. Well, in fact, there are many myths to be cleared out. First of all, you didn't have any volcano visible at all. And that is something that can be shocking, but if you speak and have a lunch maybe with a volcanologist or an anthropologist or an archaeologist, he will tell you so many truths about Pompeii that you really would be surprised to know. First of all, so we're talking about the volcano. Today it's a towering volcano. But at the time of Pompeii, it didn't exist for the simple reason that it started to exist that day of the eruption. From that day, it started to grow and become what we see today. So what could the Pompeians see? Very simple, there was a small mound with a crest, and you can still see it today. It's exactly where the big volcano is sitting today. And if you could see it at that time, you could have seen so many woods. You could have seen, I don't know, deers. I mean, Pompeians would probably go there to collect woods, pick up mushrooms, make love. It was a friend that betrayed them. So that's the first thing, no volcano. The first myth to clear out. And then another thing is the lava. You didn't have a single drop of lava getting to Pompeii, not a single one, but gases, ashes, lapilli, and so on. So that's another myth, and we will see what happened exactly. A third myth is about the date of the eruption. We know that everything happened the 24th of August, 79 AD. But how do we know that? But we know that because Pliny the Young wrote that in a letter. He was a witness. Actually, if you try to see, there are at least seven witnesses, seven survivals of the eruption. Today, I would like also to spend some time to answer one question, that is, would we have survived eruption had we been here almost 2,000 years ago? So Pliny the Young said that everything happened the 24th of August. But how do we know that? I told you there was a letter. This letter, though, is not here anymore. It vanished in time. But in the Middle Ages, the monks started to write some copies of that letter. And so we have three families of that old letter made by monks who were writing, copying, and another one would copy the copy and so forth. But of course, they would make mistakes. So is the date right or not? Well, if you see the different letters, you will see that there are different dates. One says 9 days before the calends of September, which is the 24th of August. Another one says 9 days before the calends of November, which is the 24th of October. Where is the answer? Well, the answer is buried here in the strata of Pompeii. In fact, archaeologists have been finding nuts, have been finding chestnuts, dates, dried figs, which are not really summer fruits, or summer food, but rather you find them in the fall. And they've been finding so many little clues about not a warm weather. For instance, people were dressed up with very warm clothes, with scarves, for instance. So that means that probably it was a very cold climate, which is makes more sense if it is around November. But one interesting clue, though, is about wine. In the diggings, in the decades, in the past, archaeologists found some big jars containing wine. So what the Romans would do is that they would have grape harvest, and they would collect grape juice, put that in those big, gigantic jars called dolia, and they would wait 10 days for it to boil, to ferment, and then 20 days just to check that everything was okay, and then they would cover and seal everything. And that's exactly what the archaeologists found. So as a matter of fact, grape harvest was over at least from a month. And that would probably tell you that the dates of the eruption was around the end of October. So 24th of October makes sense. So that's, of course, there's no definite proof, but that's interesting to see that such a known site like Pompeii really is still an open site with many discoveries to be done. Another myth to be clear out is that Pompeii, we always see that in the movies, was a city with wealthy people, with banquets, gladiators, and so on. Well, that's not the truth. In the day of the eruption, it was a city full in crisis. There was no running water. No running water, so no bathhouses, the terme. You didn't see anyone, you know, having fun in the terme because you didn't have water. There was one terme working who had like his own reservoir of water, so maybe people would go there, but there was a big crisis. And another thing is that, well, you didn't have a lot of people like in the old times in Pompeii, and because you had a lot of earthquakes. Earthquakes were a signal of the eruption close, coming, getting close, like the magma was pushing and provoking those earthquakes. So many people, especially aristocracy, had gone away. You had new people, new rich, former slave, the liberti, so-called, who would buy fancy houses and they would live there. But you didn't have the old society of Pompeii. You didn't have running water. Running water was not there because probably the aqueduct was broken in some places, maybe due to earthquakes, maybe due to the swelling of the soil, of the earth. We don't know exactly. So as you see, there are many myths to be cleared out. So let's go to the day of the eruption. What happened exactly? And let's try to answer the question, would I have survived? Well, first of all, let's go to that day. If it was the 24th of October, it was a Friday. Clear sky. We know that because one of the witnesses who was living 30 kilometers away from here saw everything. So imagine that it was probably, we don't know, of course, the end of October, clear sky, maybe a very cold morning. And then what happened? Well, we know from the letter of Pliny the Young that everything started more or less at noon, lunchtime. Well, volcanologists found some clues that everything happened slightly before. Well, Pliny didn't see that. He was 30 kilometers away, but probably the volcano started to open, crack open in that morning. Because you see, that small, well, long mound, similar to the back of a whale that betrayed the Romans, was not a mound. It was a volcano, a very old volcano, a silent volcano, who has not been erupting for the last centuries. So no one knew it was a volcano. But that morning, he woke up, and it started to crack open. And exactly, let's say, the first hours of the morning were terrible. People, let's say, started to gather in the forum, which is, you know, it was the central place, central square of Pompeii. Everyone would gather there in the morning usually just to get information, to meet friends. It was just like a TV set of that at that time. And they started to gather and they saw something weird. That very low mound was covered with a kind of fog, let's see, and with ashes that had covered one of the sides. It looked like it had snowed. And they started to speak one with the other. What happened? Well, some people probably came from the countryside telling strange things, telling people, well, you know, we hear noises like thunders. There is a strange smell of sulfur just from that mount. But then something happened. The whole thing started to explode. The mouth got opened, and you had a gigantic column of ashes, vapors, going up in the sky. It would reach more than 32 kilometers of height in the hours, which is three times what actually a jetliner can reach. So just imagine people seeing that column going high in the sky, being just staring at something. They didn't know even what a volcano was. Well, this is just the beginning of the tragedy. If you think about that cone going up and expanding in the air, that's what Pliny the Young tells us, you can imagine like a big stain of ink getting bigger and bigger, covering the sun. And then people started to hear something. It was just a noise of grail, a noise of something falling. Actually, you had the lapilli. You can see them all around us. Lapilli, what is a lapilli? It's a very, very small rock, but very light. It floats in the water. It's just like a piece of cork. It doesn't really kill you, but it is something falling from the sky. What is it? Well, just imagine a bottle of champagne. You open it, you have foam coming up, but if you see the in the lower part of the bottle, the wine is still watery. I mean, you still have wine, but as the wine goes up in the neck, it transforms itself into foam. And that's exactly what that volcano did. The magma in the magmatic chamber was magma, but as it came up, it was just like a foam, a solidified foam that turned out to be those lapilli falling. So people started to, just to see, to hear that, those pieces of rock, very, very, very small and very light, hitting the tiles. But they were not the killer. So I asked myself, why didn't the people go away? Well, if you go and see the stratus of the lapilli, you will see, you will find rocks that big, gigantic, big rocks coming from the volcano, coming from kilometers, really, killers like meteor falling from the sky. Actually, in Ercolano, which is not too far away from here, in the past, a skeleton of a man without the legs were found, was found close to him. There was like big, a gigantic rock falling from that volcano. And then, so people, just imagine, started to see those rocks coming down, smoking rocks, hitting the roofs, making holes in the roofs, so people start to go away. They started what to do what you and me had done, would have done, that is going back home, looking for the people we love. And just, it was panic everywhere. As a matter of fact, that was a time when you would have your life saved. If you had fled, if you had gone away from Pompeii, you could have survived. Why? Because the lapilli started to accumulate in the soil for hours. But after 2 or 3 hours, there was that strait of lapilli, more or less. After that time, you couldn't see anything outside Pompeii. You couldn't see the roads, just like when you have a heavy snow. You couldn't see anything, so where could you go? And another thing is that you had like a fog coming down. It was actually like, imagine a desert storm. You had like ashes coming down. You couldn't see at more than 1 or 2 meters. And these ashes were containing pieces of glass, actually, that were actually hurting your windpipes. So you had to breathe with a cloth dipped in the water. It was really a nightmare. So it is normal to think that people just hid in their houses. What happened then? Well, the lapilli started to accumulate. Once they reached something like a meter, a cubic meter, that would be equivalent of 6 men as weight. So you had the roof starting to collapse. Actually, 1/3 of the people found dead in Pompeii died due to the collapsing of the roofs or the floors. Probably you had also earthquakes in that process. So people were in the houses screaming, asking for help. No one could see anything. It was like the end of the world for them. And that for 12 hours. 12 hours later, let's say at 1 o'clock in the morning, let's move and go to Ercolano. Ercolano is another town very close to the sea, between the sea and the volcano, which is about 6 kilometers away from the volcano. Pompeii is about 8 kilometers away. So when archaeologists started to dig through the stratas in Ercolano, they couldn't find dead people, only a few scattered skeletons. So everyone thought that the inhabitants of Ercolano escaped somewhere. They actually managed to survive. But once the archaeologists reached the beach and got to the arches, the arcades, where usually the fishing boats were parked, just like garage, they found 300 skeletons. They all died in a single moment. When you see those skeletons, you realize something. They all died without defending themselves. It's just as if something had unplugged life from their bodies, just boom. And what happened, and that's the volcanologists would tell you that, is that the gigantic column going up in the sky at a certain time couldn't stand, and it sat on itself, just went down and transformed itself into deadly avalanches made of gas and ashes, coming down at the speed of 100 kilometers per hour with a, let's say, a heat of between 500 and 600 degrees Celsius. So that killed the people instantly. If you want to think what happened, just imagine being on the shore and watching in the night the volcano, the red part of the, let's say, of the eruption would instantly being covered by that avalanches coming down. You couldn't see anything without, but you know, volcanologists would tell you, well, maybe you could see some flares, something like a flock of red hot bats coming towards you. And people were instantly killed. The fact that you have the bone in contact with the ash layers means that skin, organs, muscles got vaporized in a matter of a second, few seconds. So people died violently. Let's go back to Pompeii. It's morning. People hear that things are changing. Probably you don't have the rain of lapilli anymore. So they want to go away. But you have so many lapilli, it's impossible to open the door. So actually people go outside from the roofs and they start to run away. But that at that time, the volcano does the same thing again, sits on himself and transforms his column on those deadly avalanches of gas. The first one stops right at the suburbia of Pompeii. The second one kills anyone on the street. And that's what you see, or those people you see in those glass frameworks. These are the people killed in that moment. And a third one would come again and break down walls, open the roofs and kill people inside. And then there is another one, a last one, who is so powerful that goes all the way, even at 30 kilometers away. And Pliny the Young, the one that wrote that letter, was almost afraid to die, and he was staying at 30 kilometers away. So this is what happened exactly in Pompeii. So what you see today is a place that probably don't tell you much about these problems, these atmosphere that happened. But when you find yourself in front of one of those bodies inside the frame, the glass frame, just remember that these are not statues. These are not petrified people. These are people in the process of dying, in that intimate moment of their life. And we, I guess, should pay respect to them every time. Thank you.